ओके मैडम भी आ गई है,
लेटेस्ट आई जस्ट गॉट हिज मैसेज.
ओके जूली
मैडम भी सर.
ओके
गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन. आई बी प्रेजेंटिंग ऑन प्री ऑपरेटिव प्रिपरेशन टू ऑब्टेन सैटिस्फैक्टरी रिजल्ट्स इन सर्जरी रिक्वायर्स अ केयरफुल अप्रोच टू प्रिपेयर फॉर प्रिपरेशन ऑफ पेशेंट्स. स्पेसिफिक पेशेंट ग्रुप्स हैव स्पेसिफिक नीड्स. हाई रिस्क पेशेंट्स शुड बी आइडेंटिफाइड अर्ली एंड अप्रोप्रिएट मेजर्स शुड बी टेकन टू रिड्यूस कॉम्प्लिकेशंस. प्री ऑपरेटिव कंसल्टेशन. It is the interaction between the patient and the surgeon preoperatively, which is very important. It allows the surgeon to assess the medical condition of the patient, to evaluate overall health status, determine the risk factors for the procedure, and discuss the procedure with the patient, as well as explain possible complications in perioperative period. Preoperative consultation creates a doctor-patient relationship for which the patient develops, on basis of which the patient develops trust on the surgeon. Preoperative risk stratification. It can be based on the procedure or on the health status of the patient. Based on the type of the procedure, the complication rate increases. For example, in emergency, the complication rate is more in emergency procedure, followed by urgent, followed by planned elective procedure. In emergency, example is patients of penetrating trauma or perforation peritonitis or ruptured aneurysm, urgent surgeries like acute appendicitis, intestinal obstruction, or wound debridement, in which there is some amount of time period on from patient's admission till we take the patient to the OT. And in planned procedure like hernioplasty, varicose veins, breast malignancy, the time to get appropriate preoperative evaluation is more. So the complication rate is the least in the elective procedure.
So this is important, Julie. It is we are using it, this chart, in our today's COVID scenario.
Yes.
So if these are the patients, we do not wait for a COVID report. Right? If somebody asks you in whom you will wait for a COVID report, this is the cases where you straightway take the patient because the COVID, and consider it COVID positive and operate, like this patient, where patient cannot wait more than 2-3 hours. It will be all right when the speed test comes and if we can do it. Otherwise, in such cases, we should not wait for any report apart from which are bare essentials. These are the patients where even a CT or any similar investigations can be avoided and they are justified. Do you understand? This urgent is where you can wait 6 to 12 hours or even 24 hours. And those are the cases where you go for a COVID test, you do a further investigation if required and prepare the patient. So we usually consider it as an emergency, semi-emergency and plan like that. But understand, this is a real emergency where patient cannot wait for more than 2-3-4 hours. So where it is important. So this is a very important point. And in such cases, operating without proper preparation is justified. Do you understand the patient? If you normal circumstances, you need certain investigation. Anesthetist will ask certain investigation. But these are the cases where it is justified even if you have not done X-ray chest sometimes. That is a point you should understand, that investigations are not mandatory apart from blood grouping, which is must in most of these cases, which is a real indicated. Rest of the investigation depends upon the availability and speed with which you can do. So here, most of the time, fast will be sufficient if it is a traumatic, or the standard USG is sufficient when it is there, because which is done bedside and you take most of the disease. Okay.
Now, based on the patient's comorbidities, two main prognostic scoring systems are in current use. The first is ASA classification, which is the most commonly and most widely used. Second is APACHE system. APACHE stands for Acute Physiology and Chronic Health Evaluation. It helps to predict outcome of patients admitted in ICU and it was previously used only for ICU patient. It has now been applied for patients undergoing surgery as well. It includes 12 acute physiological variables, patient's age and chronic health points. And based on these three, the score is given to the patient. It is a bit complicated system. ASA system, on the other hand, is the simple and widely accepted. ASA stands for American Society of Anesthesiologists. 50% of patients presenting for elective surgery are in ASA grade 1, and operative mortality rate for these patients is less than 1 in 10,000. There are 5 grades of ASA. Grade 1, in grade 1, the patient is described as healthy and 30-day mortality rate is 0.1%. Grade 2 is patient with mild systemic disease but no functional limitations, and the mortality rate is 0.7%. Grade 3 is severe systemic disease with definite functional limitation, and the mortality rate is 3.5%. Grade 4 is severe systemic disease with constant threat to life, in which the mortality rate is 18.3%. And grade 5 is moribund patient, unlikely to survive 24 hours with or without operation. And the mortality rate for this grade is 93.3%. There is also another grade, grade 6, described at some books, which is for brain dead patients who opt for organ donation. And
okay. Yes.
And grade E is given in emergency operation. So,
yes. So irrespective of grade, E means you have to operate.
Yes.
So the point is, you can argue with the anesthetist that there is no need for particular investigation, but we are handicapped. But this you all must know by heart, which is very important, because this is what our institute follows. ASA grading 1, 2, 3, 4. So the remember, and this is very important for all surgeons to know, because if the anesthetist is giving any grade, you should be aware, and in a common terminology, you should explain to the patient that actually what does it mean when you say ASA grade 3, right? And this is an important point. Remember, this is what the anesthetist is justified to say, death on the table.
This the anesthetist that takes the explains the risk to the patient, as well as the surgeon should also know the mortality rate for each, yes, and every grade.
This is very important. Yes.
In grade 3 and 4, there is a vast difference between mortality. So you have to explain the patient also that grade 3 is only 18.3 and grade 4 is 93. It's a very vast difference.
It is grade 5. The point is here also 3 and 4, 3.5 to 18%. On lighter side, this is what happens. Yes.
That even grade 1 is 0.1%, actually speaking, 0.1% is very high. Considering our workload that we do in civil hospital or any corporate hospital, that is what we need to tell. Because when the patient comes to us, their language is, sahib, normal operation channel. You need to explain it to them. Of course, not frighten them, that even in a healthy patient, 0.1% mortality is considered. Even in a healthy patient.
And that is very important. Remember, the patient of 93% is not going to create any problem. Problem usually arises in grade 1 and 2, where the patient's expectations are very high. So here it is very important that you investigate the patient fully, do all the necessary investigation, but still some or other time in your practice, you will come out with the catastrophe. And at that time, it is very important that you have explained the patient about risk and you have done all necessary investigation. Remember, grade 4 and 5, you may cut the corner, should not, but can. But 1 or 2, the point is that, it is a minor operation, why should I do this test? So forget about it, 1 in 10,000 is very high as far as, and it do happen. And remember, most of the allegation or medical legal cases occur in grade 1 and 2. Where the patient's expectations are very high. Don't consider that, he has given ASA risk 2. Patient should be able to understand what does he is falling into when he says ASA risk 2 and he gives consent. Because they consider it is of no significance. For patient, it is always black and white. For us, it is gray. patient considered that, oh, there was no risk, patient is hale and hearty. And we have seen the patient who is having only 20, 25 years, operated for gynecomastia, operated for hernia, die suddenly. And that is the area where it is very important to know the mortality rate in all the patients. Or grade. Grade 4 on lighter side, remember, there is a vast difference even in mortality, as madam has said, between 3 and 4. So anesthetists tend to, particularly in a government hospital or in the corporate hospital or bigger hospital, tend to consider all case risk 4. You understand? So it is, and again, you will describe what is grade 3, and you can see that severe systemic disease, constant threat to life. Actually, there is no actual division apart from anesthetics and certain investigations. But remember, grade 4 and 5 are very high risk for all, because 18% is a very high mortality in any circumstances. So for particularly for our registrar and first year, you should understand when the anesthetists write down, take a consent of risk 4. Patient may or may not understand, but you should understand what is risk 4. And then you should weigh it against the type of surgery you are doing. Is it mandatory? Is it going to improve the patient or not? For a 5, it is not an issue, because you will take a patient 5 when you feel that patient is definitely needing surgery. And if you do not operate, patient is going to die anyway. So in if the risk 5 is there, and then you should ask yourself, is the patient going to live if I do not operate? If there are slightest chances that patient is going to live, better not to operate. You understand? That's why this is very important ASA risk. And all of you must know it by heart. Okay.
Routine preparation for surgery. It includes the following points. Complete history, physical examination, blood investigations, informed consent, marking the site or site of operation, preoperative skin preparation, preoperative fasting, surgical safety checklist, antibiotic prophylaxis, and thromboembolic prophylaxis.
Julie, are you going to describe this in detail or this is the end? So I would like to discuss one point here.
Sir, I would describe each and every point in detail.
Very good. Then you should, because this is important. Okay. Yes.
For the surgical history, history of presenting complaints determines the urgency, whether patient is, how urgent should patient get an operation. Systemic assessment by surgical history is done to rule out if any other systems are involved. Past medical and surgical history are important, whether patient had any previous operation or whether patient has any bleeding tendency, any previous reaction to any anesthetic agent that is known to the patient, or any systemic illness that might affect general and anesthetic treatment. All this can be gained by asking the patient. Drugs and allergy history is also very important, especially for the anesthetist, because there are certain drugs that interact with anesthesia that patient has been chronically taking, and also certain drugs affect the metabolism of certain anesthetic agents. So drug history is very important. Whether patient is taking steroid or not for longer time, drugs for hypertension, ischemic heart disease, to be continued over perioperative period. So that is to be known preoperatively that on what drugs patient is currently.
Yes, and it is, yes, Julie, this is important point. One more important for all of us is, if patient is taking medicine for diabetes, hypertension, ischemic heart disease, you should always ask the anesthetist whether on the day of surgery it should be taken or it should be omitted in the morning. Because certain drugs can be taken, certain drugs cannot be taken. So this is important. Apart from anticoagulant, I think you are going to describe anticoagulant separately. Yes. So we'll not discuss. But remember, a simple example. Some anesthetists believe that antihypertensive should be taken in the morning. I think Manoj Singh is there. Manoj?
Yes, sir. I agree with you.
Yes,
there
sir.
Is a controversy in
timing
of antihypertensives.
Yes.
In across the surgery, you are not talking of only one surgery.
Yes.
Every surgery, top to bottom, even if the duration of anesthesia is more than 4 hours, except beta blocker, no drug is proven to save life. So I will only recommend to take beta blocker. That also never a Excel formulation.
Yes.
Okay. If you take an Excel formulation and suppose you bleed intraoperatively and you need a lot of blood and you go into hypotension, then there is a catastrophe because the Excel action will be really prolonged. So 48 hours before the Excel, all Excel preparation, all combination preparation should be split into short acting ones and beta blocker should be given.
Okay. So the, because the most of our resident have a problem. This is a mainly resident based. So you guide them accordingly. That's what I mean.
Yes, so only beta blocker, that too, if you are on Celocaine XL, beta blocker, all the Excel formulation should not be used.
Okay.
Only simple beta blocker, that too, if you feel that surgery duration is more, you have anticipated blood loss, then you can make it half dose. But you should give before surgery.
Because the
how much hours before surgery? How much hours before surgery? Because our surgery usually start at 9 o'clock in the morning. So when should our patient take?
Madam, 6 o'clock in the morning.
6 o'clock. Okay.
6 o'clock in the morning.
So beta blocker is not contraindicated, but sometimes some anesthetists I have said that they say you should not give beta blocker, heart block this, that, and even
bronchospasm.
No, this is just a joke. Because the residents have a lot of confusion because of that.
Yes, sir.
Some believe that antihypertension should be given in morning, but should not be.
Right. Okay. So beta blocker should be.
Other common problem we've actually faced is the patient will give that patient is taking his drugs for hypertension, but they don't have the strip or the name of the drug. So it is very important to get the strip or to know which drug is actually patient is taking, because they will give you the detail in the layman term, and it might be some, we might miss an, any important drug like steroid or anything. Family history is important for malignant hyperthermia and bleeding disorders, and personal history important for smoking and alcoholism, as it also affects the perioperative complications. Physical examination includes a full physical examination, general examination to look for pallor, icterus, edema, systemic examination in which we look all the system, that is cardiovascular, pulmonary system, abdomen, renal system, hepatobiliary system. I will describe each in detail later on. And in emergency cases, primary survey and secondary survey is enough. That is, in primary survey, we look for airway, breathing and circulation and mental status. And in secondary survey, if we are suspecting any blunt abdominal trauma, to go for USG, etc. So minimum investigation, survey for emergency examination, and a detailed for elective procedures, complete general and systemic examination is needed.
Manoj, just a moment.
Yes,
I think Apurva, have you introduced him or not? I think Apurva is. Apurva?
No, sir, actually.
Yes. So just introduce him and then I will. So Manoj, what we are doing actually here is, she is presenting it, but anytime,
yes,
if you will want to clarify or the or
yeah, I will raise my hand and then I'll interrupt it here. No problem.
Then you can straightway interrupt, because others, we are not going, because all others have a muted. So you can anytime interrupt, because I may not see your hand. That is, you can anytime. That's what.
Okay,
for residents' benefit, this is a
very
casual meeting, so don't worry about it. That is a
Yes, sir.
Okay, Apurva, please go ahead.
I don't mind. Sir, we are all your students. We don't mind at all.
Okay, thank you.
It's a pleasure for me to be here, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
After history and examination, preoperative investigation are to be done for confirmation of diagnosis, for exclusion of alternative diagnosis, to know the extent of the disease, for assessment of fitness for the surgery, and for medical legal considerations. The first and most commonly done test is complete blood count, which is the most common and must in almost all the procedures. It includes all emergency preoperative cases, all elective preoperative cases over 60 years, all elective preoperative cases in adult females, and if the surgery is likely to result in significant blood loss, and if there is suspicion of blood loss or anemia or sepsis or chronic kidney disease or coagulation problems. In cases like excision of sebaceous cyst or lipoma that is done under local anesthesia, we might not need a full blood count in a healthy patient less than 55 years of age. Renal function tests. It is required in all preoperative cases over 65 years. All patients with cardiopulmonary disease or taking diuretics or steroids, all patients with history of renal or liver disease or abnormal nutrition status, and all patients with history of diarrhea or vomiting or other metabolic or endocrine diseases. Random blood sugar.
Manoj, because this is some, this is all right, 65.
Yeah, I think now things are a little tricky as you see.
Yes.
I would like to add a bit of, Julie, you should remove this slide at all. Renal function, please do it in all, because there is no point. Renal function, we only mean sodium, potassium and creatinine. That's it.
Let's see.
So I like how you nicely said, Julie, you want to do CBC in all. Let's do sodium, potassium, creatinine in all, because you don't even see her the patient's excretory function. But you have to match it with any perioperative or anesthesia implications on the patient's body. Okay. Even if the patient is young, say for example, and the anesthetist is giving the patient propofol. Okay. And propofol sometimes is a very nasty drug. You may feel that it is a sebaceous cyst. You may feel it is a very small surgery. You're doing under sort of regional and short GA. Then also 10 ml of propofol can hurt the kidney so badly, you have to prove in future, suppose there is a litigation or any problem from the family end, that her baseline renal function was normal. It was an anesthesia stress. So for that, please do it in all patients. Sodium, potassium, creatinine.
Yes, I absolutely agree. That's
Urine RM. Urine also, RM is also a renal function test. So because we don't know how kidneys will react to the anesthesia, heart will react to anesthesia, so our excretory function beforehand only we should know.
So yes, the anesthetists are justified in asking in at least create an electrolyte in all
patients. And urine RM before, yes, they are justified.
Yes, this is important. Remember, because this may be look like below 65 tomorrow morning, my first year will fight with anesthetists. It is written in the book only 60, so it's not like that. It is very important. Almost, we do it in all cases, so we are justified in doing it. In the era of litigation, this is important, what I say. Like
correct.
Okay, Julie, continue.
Random blood sugar, it should be done in all the cases of acute abdomen and elective cases with diabetes, malnutrition, obesity, in elective cases over 60 years.
Okay, here also, beta.
Same.
I think now.
Done in sugar, all the cases.
Yeah, listen, sugar is actually the fifth vital sign. So you have to do it. And you are not asking the lab. You can do it with a finger glucometer only. So it's like TPR, BP, pain and sugar. So these are all the vital signs, you know. Pain is also vital signs for everyone. And especially surgeons, all of you should know the pain score beforehand. And then RBS should be done in all.
Coagulation studies, they are important for patients with history of bleeding disorder, for liver disease, or patients with excessive alcohol use, they tend to have an altered INR. Patients receiving anticoagulant, PTINR should be done on the morning of the surgery, and patient is instructed to withdraw warfarin. It is very important in cardiothoracic surgery, vascular surgeries, angiographic procedures, craniotomy procedure. And as such, coagulation studies are included in minor pre-op profile. Initially, BTCT was enough, but now we go for PT, APTT, INR complete coagulation profile.
Okay.
So here BTCT, I will add. Here I will add. See, BT and CT are very good tests, but because they do not have a base, means you cannot compare. It is just very arbitrary. So you stop sending it now. I don't know, PRM sir, now are we sending BTC?
No, they are not doing it even.
Because when I was there in 2000, yeah, so we used to do it, you know.
Yes,
I remember. Yes. We used to do it very religiously and we used to really follow them, you know.
Yes.
BTCT vadhare che to aa kariye na normal che to kariye, you know. So
yes.
Now PT INR for all patient is enough. Extra coagulation studies, as you have rightly written here, are very important for microsurgeries. All microsurgeries, coagulopathy screen is important for patients who are alcoholic, as you have nicely written, bleeding disorder, liver disorder, everything. And patients who are on aspirin, you remember, you will not have basically any abnormality. But patient who are on aspirin, clopidogrel, all the newer anticoagulants, like dabigatran, all anti-10A inhibitors, patient who are on clexane, you will not see any coagulation abnormality on the labs. But then you should instruct the family that, yes, he is a patient whom the risk of surgery, not doing a surgery, is higher than the risk of bleeding. So that is why we are taking in for the patient for surgery. So we'll I think after you finish, we will discuss how to manage patients who are on anticoagulant and underwent a surgery in an emergency basis. We'll discuss that at the end of the talk.
Manoj, somebody has asked a question. The CPA court, I think this is beyond our scope.
Okay.
You can read it in chat if you want to comment. Otherwise, let it pass.
We'll pass. I'll read and then we'll take it at the end.
Okay. Yes. Okay. Julie, continue.
Only one thing I would like to ask. How long before you should omit this when it comes to clexane and warfarin?
Okay, sir. I will answer this. If the patient has pulmonary embolism and the patient has pulmonary embolism within 2 to 4 weeks, means that is life-threatening. Okay. So that is the most life-threatening cause and need of anticoagulation. So you should give it 12 hours before. Okay. 12 hours before. That is for the disease for which the anticoagulation is given. Means patient ne pulmonary embolism che and tame GI operate karo cho. So ena mate clexane should be continued post-operatively also and pre-operatively also you give 12 hours before the surgery. But if you feel that your surgery increases the risk of DVT, means say for example you are doing a spine surgery, you are doing a surgery which is graft surgery, micrografts or neurosurgery, where you don't need any anticoagulant. So then 24 hours before you should stop. For risk spine surgery, we give preoperatively 6 hours back and we give after 12 hours of the surgery because surgery itself is a risk of developing DVT. But je logo already pehla thi le raha hoy, warfarin should be stopped at least 4 days back because warfarin has an effect which continues to last. PT INR may or may not be the gold standard to monitor because many times the lab is also not standardized, the INR is also not standardized. So suppose patient is on warfarin and you are planning an elective surgery, stop it 4 days back, put the patient on clexane, do INR daily, and when the INR is below 1.5 or around 1.5, and 12 hours before you give clexane because he is receiving clexane for a life-saving indication. Khali DVT mate leto hoy to tame band kari shako cho. That's not because DVT hoy and you are operating on the stomach, then there is not high risk of embolization during the surgery. So you give 12 hours before and then you continue the surgery.
Sir, most of the time in elective patients, say cardiac patients who have undergone CABG or angioplasty, and most of them are either on clopivas or aspirin.
Such
cold cases, do we need to continue clexane or we can simply stop aspirin before 4 days without any issue?
Clexane, sir, should be stopped. Minimum.
Aspirin and clopivas.
I'll tell you. Clopidogrel should be stopped 5 days before the surgery. Aspirin, newer recommendations, very, very latest, maybe 2019, are depending on what surgery you are doing. If you are doing a very cool surgery, 48 hours is the time we should stop. Means suppose Monday you are posting, so the patient will not take on Saturday and Sunday. And Monday he undergoes a surgery. But if the patient is undergoing a heart surgery, so they do it on the aspirin only. CABG, they are now doing on aspirin because that's very irrational to stop because he already has a clotted arteries. But for general people, elective surgery, clopidogrel 4 to 5 days before to stop and aspirin 48 hours before to stop.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Liver function test, must in all patients with upper abdominal pain, jaundice, hepatic disease, chronic alcoholic patients, and screening for hepatitis B and C is also important. Blood group and
cross-group.
I'll add here. Liver function test generally includes a lot of tests, means bilirubin, SGPT, SGOT, GGTP, alkaline phosphatase, proteins. All are only required in the upper slide, as you wrote, first part. Second is also fine. If the patient is found to be hepatitis B, C, you do it. But in all patients undergoing a general anesthesia, even spinal anesthesia, SGPT is must. As I told for electrolytes, SGPT is must because, again, anesthetic implication, post-op bleeding related issues, later on if the patient has develops a lot of bleeding and needs a lot of blood and goes into DIC. Background SGPT will serve you as a guide ki base ma patient na kahin problem na tu. And PTINR also you can correlate. If PTINR was normal, SGPT was normal. So everything what happened post-op is related to the stress of the surgery. So SGPT in all patients, complete LFT in the patients whom you have written here.
Manoj, there is a one question I would also like to. Does the dose matter in aspirin?
Yes. So I think I read that question. There are three questions coming here. So is dose of aspirin taking a matter? Yes. Now patients taking 75 mg of aspirin, actually they are not required even to take aspirin because aspirin prophylactically to abhi koi role aj nahi rahe. So 75 par leta ho, so you can straight away operate them because that's very, very low dose. Within 24 hours, you can stop and take it. But generally, if the patient is taking therapeutic dose, it's always 150 mg. In a 48 hours, pehla band kari, you should do it. You can do the surgery.
Great, great. Okay, Julie, continue.
Blood group and cross match must in all emergency preoperative cases. And when there is suspicion of blood loss or when there is anemia or coagulation, studies are altered. Chest X-ray, all elective preoperative cases over 60 years of age, all cases of cervical, thoracic or abdominal trauma, patients with acute respiratory symptoms or signs, for thoracic surgeries, in malignant diseases, in viscous perforation, in patients with history of TB, patients with thyroid enlargement.
Okay, Julie, I will ask you one question on X-ray. In COVID, now you should write in all patients, sir.
In all patients.
Okay. In COVID era, now all patients. Okay.
And what about smokers?
So I was coming. That was my second question, sir. Julie, if the patient has smoking and the X-ray does not tell you anything, what will he do? He is posted for a GI surgery. What will he do? X-ray is normal, unrewarding, but he has a significant smoking history for the last 5 to 10 years.
If what the patient is chronic smoker, I would like to go for pulmonary function test to assess the forced vital capacity of the, as well as the compliance of the lungs.
Have you written it in your slide? Is it going to come?
Yes, sir. I'll detail. Okay. I have described.
Actually, Manoj, now our anesthetists are asking it. And they are doing it. So
PFT in a lot of cases.
PFT in almost all cases.
I think in almost all cases. It was not heard of.
हाँ सर हमें लोगों जारे टीवी चेस करता था तुमने याद हो डीआर पटेल साहब ने यूनिट में त्यारे तो हमें ना था हमें तो आईने फिटनेस आप ही देता है एक्सरे जो है आपी देता था
exactly I know and that's why we have called you
yes sir
okay. Yes PFT has become very important now yes sir okay Julie continue
ECG is to be done in all patients and ECG is done within 30 days of surgery is or less if condition warrants for patients with non-cardiac disease and with the ECG done within 90 days prior to surgery for all patients greater than 50 years.
Now on ECG, have you seen your anesthetist refusing the patient to operate? You koi condition che ki Julie tamne ene kidu ki nahi ave aa ECG jo ne humne nahi kari hai. Evu kai che?
Sir, usually if we get ECG reported by a medicine resident and if they advise, we go for 2D echo. So if there is any abnormality in ECG or echo, they postpone the patient. Otherwise, if they find the ECG normal, they don't postpone the patient.
But listen to me, as a surgeon,
what is the condition where the anesthetist will refuse surgery on looking at the ECG?
So Julie, only see, you don't refer to medicine. just because we don't know. We don't practice this way. So two conditions on ECG, remember all of you. Heart block. And I think Mr. Dr. Aziz has little long QT interval. Long QT interval is relative contraindicated. So it comes under heart block only. Any kind of heart block, any kind of active arrhythmia going on, and third, any acute coronary syndrome, the patient straight away does not go for surgery. Unless he has head injury or any acute surgery, you feel that the life is at risk. Otherwise, arrhythmia going on, brady or tachyarrhythmia, brady means heart blocks, or acute coronary syndrome, your patient does not go for surgery. He doesn't even go to medicine resident. He is transferred under medicine. Okay, Julie? Apart from that,
that's why she is laughing.
any patient who has chronic LBBB, means left bundle brand block, chronic QT changes. So that patient probably goes for medicine, goes for echo. That is also fine. But any acute arrhythmia is going on, brady or tachy, or acute coronary syndrome, the patient does not undergo surgery because risk of death on table is very high.
Yes, really, you are going to say something?
Yes, I was just going forward.
Okay. So there is another thing. What is the actual indication of doing echo? Okay, all patients above certain age or something like that.
I think let her finish this PFT also, sir, because cardiorespiratory thing I will discuss, sir.
Okay, sure. Thank you. Continue, Julie.
Other investigations that to be done preoperative that are performed according to the requirement, ultrasound, CT scan, MRI, depending on the patient's condition.
Okay.
Now consent.
So where did you take PFT?
I'll describe each and every system after a routine preoperative 10 points that I've discussed.
Okay.
Consent. Consent should be voluntary and it should be informed consent. Supported decision making is considered good practice. By supported decision making, the patient should be explained all the possible complications of the surgery. And as well as alternative treatment is also discussed with the patient. And after that, the patient is asked to make a decision whether he or she wants to go further with the surgery or not. So consent is very important. It also has medico-legal importance. And capacity is needed for a patient to give their consent. For a child less than 16 years, the consent is given by the parents or the guardian. And for age more than 16 years, the patient can give consent of his own.
Whenever you are taking consent, you should see that what language patient and patient's relatives are knowing. And you have to write down about the consent in that language. That is most important thing. Sometimes there is a consent written into the English or Hindi and patient do not know that language. Then it creates problem if there is litigation.
For emergency life-saving conditions in which whether the patient is not conscious or patient has arrived with no relatives, in civil hospital, the RMO gives the consent for the surgery.
The operating surgeon can also give the consent.
Yes.
He was going to say the same thing. Okay. Yes.
Sir, one point before going ahead, Julie, at times it happens that during the process of surgery, you need to change the way of surgery. For example, you are going for an ileostomy or you are going for a nephrectomy where you had not planned it. In those cases, if I am not wrong, according to the medico-legal aspect, the patient is supposed to give a consent. So unless and until it's a life-saving surgery, the patient's relative cannot give the consent if you want to change it. We do it all the time, but I think medico-legally, because I remember in one of the cases when oophorectomy was carried out and the patient then went for a litigation and the judge gave a verdict in favor of the patient. So unless and until a redo surgery is not possible, you should continue with the planned management and not go for a varied management.
Yes, Apurva.
Sir, what do you say?
It is right. The problem is that this itself is a big topic. The one point, yes, you are right. You cannot exactly, because this consent is very implications are there. Consent itself is, but one thing is very sure for a pointer part, as far as we are concerned, if there is a slightest doubt that patient may require some kind of stomy of some removal of organ, you should always take consent before that, saying that if it is required, we will carry it out. Because we come across so many patients that per operative, you feel that this patient needs the stomy. And if you have not taken consent, you ideally cannot do stomy. The patient's relative's consent is not valid in court. That is for sure. So it is always better to take an elaborate and detailed consent according to the disease, which is very important. Suppose I give example, if you are going to operate for a pheochromocytoma of the suprarenal, it is always prudent to take a consent for nephrectomy. And if patient refuses the consent for nephrectomy, you should not be operating that patient like that. But once in a while, if you come across when you have not taken consent and you feel that patient will need this thing, if avoidable, you should avoid it and go again. Unless it is unavoidable, once in a while it will happen. In that case, with all the written document, it is a very gray zone. But remember, consent is a big topic that you should remember. Okay.
Preoperative skin preparation. It is important in preventing surgical site infections, and effectiveness of the preparation depends on the type of the antiseptic used and method of application. There has been trial between choice of antiseptic between chlorhexidine alcohol versus povidone iodine. In most of the trial, they have shown chlorhexidine alcohol better or superior than the povidone iodine. The solution should be applied in concentric circles, and the applicator should be discarded once the periphery is reached. So it should be applied, start from the incision site and then go towards the periphery. Many of the times we ask the patient to take a bath with the antiseptic solution on the night before the surgery. So the patient should be explained properly that there should not be a contact between the soap and the chlorhexidine alcohol, because the soap destroys the action of the alcohol. So just giving the patient antiseptic to the patient is not enough. How to use it is also to be explained in all the patients. And hair removal, if needed, should be accomplished by clipping with electrical clippers rather than shaving with razor, because shaving creates a breach in the skin and it gives a site for colonization of the bacteria. So preferred option is clipping over shaving. And if we don't have the facility available and we have to go for shaving, it should be done within 2 hours of surgery and not on the night before the surgery. Because if we do it on the night before the surgery, it gives time for colonization of the bacteria.
This is a very, very important for all residents to understand that we have come around, but still we are doing, I think, shaving. It is worldwide a topic of discussion, because the only problem on a on-table preparation is hygiene and aesthetic problem. Otherwise, everybody has come around that it should be done, preparation should be done on the table. And just for Julie, have you ever used clipper in your first year residency?
Sir, clipper we have not used, but we have used depilation cream sometimes.
Sometimes. But still, she is
sometimes
my first year.
All the appendicectomy, almost all the female appendicectomy, we go for then that cream application. That is
in
better rather
says,
than using shaving.
Depilation cream is better than shaving.
Yeah. But the problem is certain area you need to go for shaving, otherwise clipping is sufficient. It is safe. But the most important message is for all residents is there is no role of overnight shaving. It should be done at least either on table or just before. But there are certain technical issues which are usually there, because there are so many number of patients and to prepare them within 1 or 2 hours, it's difficult. But yes, this is what the theory says. Okay.
Preoperative fasting. We usually do a standard order of nil per oral past midnight, based on the theory of reduction of volume and acidity of stomach contents during surgery. Aspiration occurs during anesthesia in non-fasted patients because of effect of anesthetic and sedative medications on decreasing the airway protective reflexes. The current ASA guidelines for preoperative fastings are 8 hours of fasting after fatty or fried meal, 6 hours of fasting after light meal, and 2 hours of fasting after clear liquid intake and medications. We usually give order for after past midnight. We do not allow the patient to take clear liquids also. But the guideline says that 2 hours of fasting is enough for clear liquids.
Just try it and what our NSAT says.
We do not want to postpone the patient. That is the main aim.
Does the type of anesthesia make any difference to this hours of fasting?
I'll tell you. Yeah. So if you, this two hour is really reliable because we are on one side saying that before the surgery, we want to give the beta blocker. So anyhow, he has to take it with water, you know. So most of the patients, when they are taking a 6 o'clock, what we decided at 9 o'clock is the surgery. So you have to give that water. So it is okay to give in the morning 2 hours clear liquids because gastric emptying time for clear liquids is quite rapid. So you will not have a risk of aspiration. And I think we should follow this rather than, you know, what has been traditionally practiced of overnight fasting. That is actually increasing your own catabolism during surgery.
Yes. And one additional problem we always face is time of surgery, because we keep NBM all patient from 12 midnight.
Surgery tha Sanjay.
Sanjay, next day. In my unit and Apurva's unit is very common practice. That surgery will be done at 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock.
Yeah.
So there, the purpose of this lecture is for all residents.
So residents can give them a light meal in the breakfast when they know surgery is getting postponed.
Yes. Do you understand? That means you can plan it out and we should plan out. It is not a practical and even human to keep all the patient meal by mouth for over the period of years. So that is important. At the most 6 hours, and our half of the patient will be anyway taken after 12. So they can be given a small at least liquid, particularly in our climate. This is a very practical thing. We should follow it actually. Okay.
The surgical safety checklist. It is the universal protocol developed to prevent wrong site, wrong procedure, and wrong patient procedures. There is a concept of timeout during which the surgeon says the details about patients, the procedure he is going to do, whether any concerned complications should be kept in mind during the surgery, and the site of the surgery. This protocol includes preoperative marking of surgical site, confirming the site by comparing physician notes, consent and mark, patient identification, and ensuring the proper implants or devices are available for the procedure.
So it is a checklist. That needs to be done by the surgeon only.
Next slide is that.
Okay.
Here, this is the checklist developed by WHO. It is divided in sign in, time out, and sign out. So sign in is known as before induction of anesthesia. These things should be confirmed at least with nurse and anesthetist. That is, has the patient confirmed his or her identity, site, procedure, and consent? Is the site marked? Is the anesthesia machine and medication check complete? Is the pulse oximeter on the patient working and functioning? Does the patient have a known allergy? Whether there is difficult airway or risk of aspiration, and whether there is a risk of greater than 500 ml of blood loss. These things are to be checked before induction of anesthesia. Now, before the skin incision, the surgeon has to check the following things. Confirm all the team members have introduced themselves by name and role. Confirm the patient's name, the procedure where the incision will be made. Has the antibiotic prophylaxis has been given within the last 60 minutes? And anticipated critical events are discussed. The surgeon will say whether there is routine, which are the critical and non-routine steps, how long will the case take, and what is the anticipated blood loss. The anesthetist will say whether there is any patient-specific concerns. and the nursing staff will say about the whether there is the sterility is confirmed or not.
Okay, so can you throw some light on antibiotic prophylaxis? The dose. Yeah, I know you have a slide, but just can you elaborate now?
Usually for any procedure, we give the antibiotic when the patient is taken on table and before induction. We give cefazolin is the choice of antibiotic. Usually in all cases, we give cefotaxime when the patient is on table. And for minor procedures, when there is clean surgery, there is no role of preoperative antibiotic prophylaxis. The surgical site infection rate in clean surgery is same as that of when we don't give antibiotic prophylaxis.
Okay.
And whether the essential imaging is displayed on screen or not. So before making the skin incision, the surgeon has to check following things. And sign out is before when patient leaves the operating room, the name of the procedure is again repeated. And completion of instrument, sponge, and needle count must in all the patients, and it should be done by nurse as well as the surgeon as well, always. And specimen labeling, the specimen removed should be said aloud, including patient's name, and whether there are any equipment problems to be addressed. And discussed with the anesthetist what are the key concerns for recovery and management of this patient. The entire checklist takes 5 to 10 minutes, but it should be applied in all the elective cases.
So Julie, I'll interrupt you here. This is a very common thing, time out. Now you have a patient in the OT, okay, you know he is Magan Bhai, correct? You shifted from your surgical ward to the OT. Anesthetist knows he is Magan Bhai. Okay. Right. He knows he is Magan Bhai. But because there is another case who got delayed, and Magan Bhai's previous patient, say for example, Harish Bhai, has been wheeled into the theater. Magan Bhai is still standing outside. Okay. And because there is a lot of rush, you know, PR Modi sir, when he operates, there is more than 15 patients on the day. Okay. So Harish Bhai gets the anesthesia and he is sleeping. By mistake, Harish Bhai gets the anesthesia. You are all there. You just come. Sir is also there. How will you confirm that he is Magan Bhai or Harish Bhai? Patient is not able to speak. Nurse does not know because OT nurse is different. And the person who shifted the patient from your ward to here is different. How will you identify the patient?
Sir,
files are there. Beoni file andar ache. Harish Bhai ni panche and Magan Bhai ni panche.
Sir, we have usually all the patients have belt with their name on. So
okay.
It is important for the patient identification to see whether, and also the site of the surgery, or we have marked the incision preoperative, taking the patient before.
Beone appendectomy che.
So then we'll have to see if the patient identification band is not there. Then
yes.
Age of the patient can be a clue, or some investigations that has done, or physician notes, as I said earlier.
So remember, you have to stop the anesthetist before giving anesthesia. You should do it as you have rightly written here. But many times anesthetists are in a little hurry to induce. Okay. So as important, this is for our surgical team. It is equally important for the anesthetist also to do timeout, correct? Many times in haste, and I'm sure you all will agree, they will induce, okay? And that is where all the blame comes on all of us, the surgeons. So it should not happen, okay? The timeout should happen before, you should answer me, sir, timeout happened before induction. So there is no question of name change, okay? You can't say, ki, sir, belt, my name Jova J is belt, but belt is good, sign badge is good, some reports are good, age is good, some mark on the patient. So the identification mark is also good, but it should always happen, as your first slide shows, before anesthesia, so that this does not happen. And this has happened in the past, few unlucky patients, few unlucky team. We should never repeat in our own entire life. Barabar, Modi sir, tamar su kevu chhe? Apoor sir?
Perfectly said. And it happens almost with almost everybody during a lifetime. Yes, sir. Yes, and sir. You can never forget it.
Yes, sir.
So point well said take... and should be taken. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, continue.
So before you take, I mean, it should be habit of speaking loudly that you are taking this patient. And one more scenario is that there are two patients with the same name. That is also possible. Even we have faced that.
Even surname also are same, sir. Surname also the same.
So be very careful. There are very simple things, but in a lifetime, almost always somebody comes across it.
Yes.
So patient identification and site identification probably are the most important thing before surgery that you do.
So a resident who is bringing the patient inside or the servant who is bringing the inside, that one resident should ask the name of the patient. This should be a routine.
Yes.
And
yes.
Then what disease are you having? That is also a question should be asked.
Correct.
So that
correct.
There will not be, and which side. These three questions are very much important. Then you should ask to the patient, even if you are knowing. So there will not be any mistake.
And one more thing, ma'am, the notice board in the theater also should always have names, the person who is going to come. As soon as they go out, it should be removed.
Yes.
And the same radiology should be hooked on the X-ray viewer box.
So previously we were having this type of board in which also we were writing how much mocks are there in the...
Yes, madam. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Okay, go ahead, Julie.
Continue, Julie.
Antibiotic prophylaxis, it is not required in clean surgery unless a prosthesis is implanted. Antibiotics that are effective against expected pathogens within local hospital guidelines should be used. Plan for single shot intravenous administration at induction of anesthesia to attain maximum blood and tissue levels at the time of first skin incision, and repeat only during long operations after 4 hours or if there is excessive blood loss, because the tissue level of the antibiotic given at the time of induction is decreased after a few hours. And patients with heart valve disease or prosthesis should be protected from bacteremia caused by dental work or urethral instrumentation or any visceral surgery. The surgical site infection rates relating to wound contamination with and without antibiotic prophylaxis depends on the type of the surgery. When there is a clean surgery where no viscus is opened, the infection rate with or without prophylaxis is same. So it shows that there is no need for prophylactic antibiotic. In patients with clean contaminated surgery, like when there is viscus is opened but there is minimal spillage, the infection rate is 3% with prophylaxis and 6-9% without prophylaxis. In contaminated surgery, when the viscus is opened with spillage or there is inflammatory disease of the viscus, the infection rate with prophylactic antibiotics is 6% and without it is 13-20%. And in dirty cases, where there is pus or where there is perforation or there is we put an incision through an abscess, the infection rate is 7% with prophylaxis and it is 40% without prophylaxis. So there is a definite role of preoperative antibiotic prophylaxis in clean contaminated and dirty wound surgeries. Nutritional assessment preoperatively, the important criteria are when there is BMI less than 18.5 kilogram per meter square, serum albumin less than 3 gram per deciliter, or unintentional weight loss more than 10% over last 6 months. These criteria will... sir, am I audible?
Yeah, audible.
Yeah, yes, you are audible.
Yes, you are audible.
Okay, sir. If any of these things are present, it shows that the post-operative course of the patient will have more complication, more wound complication, and catabolism will be more in these cases. So if pre-op correction is possible, it should be done in elective cases at least. in emergency we cannot help it, but in elective cases these things should be taken care of. Low serum albumin level less than 2.2 gram per deciliter is a marker of negative catabolic state and it is a predictor of poor outcome.
So in few patients, when you are planning extra major surgery and patient is nutritionally not well, you expect that there should be a long for you have to give IV for a longer period, you should start with the CVP line and give parenteral nutrition preoperatively and build up the patient.
Like in some patients with malignancy, there is going to be a weight loss. But before taking the surgery, we should do glucose loading or give parenteral nutrition for some days to get a optimized nutritional status before going for any major surgery.
But that does not mean that any patient who is really cachectic, means he is 30 to 35 to 40 kilo, he never had even 1,000 calories per day in the last few months, you will give him dextrose 2 to 3 liters per day. He can die of it. So what is the DD? Why he will die, Julie?
When we give dextrose.
He is 30 to 40 kilos only. And
go
weight.
Into acute liver failure?
So a homework for all your residents, for you only. It's called refeeding syndrome. Okay. What madam said very nicely is you will start parenteral nutrition, but not only high glucose. So high glucose can kill the patient by a phenomena called refeeding syndrome, which is again a separate topic. So we'll not go into detail. Read it and put it in your group. Okay. Refeeding syndrome implications perioperatively.
Am I audible, Manoj?
Yes, sir.
Sorry, I lost the contact. I had some problem. Okay. Yes, sir. But I was able to hear everything. But sorry, yes, Manoj, I will have to leave. I have got some work. So Apurva and Ninaben is there. They will look after.
Yes,
thank you,
yes,
for coming.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
So Julie, let's finish in 15 because I also have a work.
Yeah.
I'm in the COVID ward, so I have to just finish some COVID work, you know.
Okay.
Thromboembolic prophylaxis. There are surgery itself is a risk factor for DVT. Surgery, malignancy, trauma, patients on oral contraceptive pills, age, obesity, all these are risk factors for DVT. So prophylaxis for DVT should be given in form of graded elastic compression stocking, intermittent pneumatic calf compression, postoperative early ambulation, and heparin prophylaxis. What kind of prophylaxis is to be given depends on the level of the risk of DVT. So in patient with low risk, early mobilization postoperatively is enough. In patients with moderate risk, we go for graded compression stocking or pneumatic calf compression, or these two things we don't commonly do. We go for low molecular weight heparin. We give 40 milligram per day. And in patients with high and very high risk, same heparin or pneumatic compression is given.
So when will you start heparin?
So for a moderate high risk patient, prophylaxis is given 12 to 24 hours after the procedure. And for very high risk, prophylaxis is started.
Why?
Sorry, ma'am.
Why after 12 hours, not immediate postoperative?
Sir, ma'am, because it alters the bleeding profile, bleeding and clotting profile, we tend to start it after the 12 to 24 hours. But if the patient has very high risk of DVT, we can start 2 to 12 hours before the surgery and restart it 12 to 24 hours after the procedure.
Manoj, can
I
you elaborate more?
Yeah, I will comment. So Julie, just go back to that slide. Okay, so here, this is very straightforward, very nicely written by her. Here, there has to be one more additional column about the risk of bleeding which surgery will put on the patient. Okay, and you have to match. So most of the surgical colleagues will never give DVT prophylaxis because they always feel a hidden risk, as you have rightly not given us the column. So column in all of your mind is bleeding thase to, drain ma vadhare aavse to, kheti thai jase, apne dodu padse, blood apu padse, surgeon blame karse, sir blame karse ki apu etle. So you have to have a crisscross table. So lower the bleeding risk, patient should get, all patients should get DVT prophylaxis. And I say in other way around, the more the skill the surgeon, all patients should receive DVT prophylaxis pre-operatively. Post-operatively, tamara upar chhe. If you feel the patient is up and above, out of the bed, next day, third day, then you stop it. But pre-operatively, there are very few surgeries where you don't give DVT prophylaxis. Probably, as you have rightly written, the level of risk is very low on first less than 40 years. Then also, if less than 40 years, you are undergoing a surgery which lasts more than 1 to 2 hours. So surgery itself is promote the varicose triad. That is called as hypercoagulation one, second is stasis and venous injury because you are undergoing a long surgery. So varicose triad, all three elements in a young male also is stimulated. So it's always good to give rather than to lose the patient with DVT and pulmonary embolism. So if the less risk of bleeding, give to all. Very high risk of bleeding, neurosurgery, cardiothoracic surgery, aortic surgery, you give the pneumatic compression device. So don't give, right? But very high risk of DVT, give always. And explain the patient that the risk of surgery is due to your high risk of getting DVTP, not because of my surgical risk. So you have to balance, write it in the consent and take a high risk consent rather than a blanket consent for all patients. So madam, apne paas hai bay consent form che, high risk consent and normal consent?
So,
preoperative nutritional strategies in major abdominal surgeries, fluid and carbohydrate loading to prevent taking care that patient does not go into refeeding syndrome. Minimal period of fasting preoperatively, if possible, we discussed that. And there is a fast track protocol, not commonly used, but it says that carbohydrate rich drink 2 hours before surgery can convert the fasted patient to fed state. So it reduces the postoperative insulin resistance. And bowel preparation, it is necessary and must in all elective abdominal pelvic surgery so that peritoneal contamination is minimum. The system-wise approach, for cardiovascular system, the leading cause of death in perioperative period in non-cardiac surgery, this is the most common cause. And much of the perioperative risk assessment and patient preparation centers on cardiovascular disease. There are a few risk indices. Goldman and revised cardiac risk index are most commonly used. I will not go into the details since we don't have the time. The ACC AHA guidelines for patients with ischemic heart disease. We always have to weigh benefit of surgery against the risk. Wait for at least 4 to 6 weeks after the episode of acute MI. And performing a PCI before non-cardiac surgery should be limited to patients with unstable CAD. Just like we discussed, if there is a ECG showing STEMI, the patient will go to medicine for PCI and not go for surgery. And patients with left main disease requiring bypass. And elective non-cardiac surgery should be delayed 14 days after balloon angioplasty. Minimum of 30 days after bare metal stent implantation and 12 months after implantation of drug-eluting stents. Because in these cases, we cannot afford to stop the antiplatelet and anticoagulant medication. Pulmonary system, assessment of pulmonary function test should be done in all the lung resection cases, thoracic procedures requiring single lung ventilation, and as we already discussed, patients undergoing major abdominal and thoracic cases in patients older than 65 years of age, having underlying medical cause, smoker, or having overt pulmonary symptoms.
Manoj, you are going to tell something about this pulmonary function test.
Yeah, let her finish, ma'am, then I'll add.
Okay.
So the tests to be done are forced vital capacity at the first second, forced vital capacity, that is sum of FEV1 plus 2 plus 3 and diffusing capacity of carbon monoxide. The risk group for postoperative pulmonary complications our age group more than 70 years, chronic smoker, renal failure, poor nutrition, patient who had a recent asthma attack, a patient with past history of intubation for asthma management, and a risk factor according to the surgery and anesthesia. And in emergency surgery, when there is thoracic, vascular, or upper abdominal surgery is done, when there is blood loss more than 4 pints of PCV, and anesthesia time more than 180 minutes, and general anesthesia. So patients with these risk factors, preoperative interventions that we can do, that is smoking cessation, at least for 2 months of planned surgery. Incentive spirometry should be started preoperatively. Hmm. We usually start it postoperatively, but it should be started preoperatively.
Yes.
And bronchodilator therapy for asthma patients, especially antibiotic therapy for pre-existing infection, pre-treatment of asthmatic patients with steroids, and encouraging exercise preoperatively.
I think you have covered. I just go back to the last slide. You covered very nicely, but don't encourage your anesthetist to give IV deriphaline and Dexona both, while induction. They have a habit of giving it both. So that's one take-home message. Only steroid is fine for asthmatic or patients who have active wheezing, you know, perioperatively. Steroid is fine. You can give it preoperatively. Early in the morning, as a circadian rhythm at 6 a.m. also, you can give Dexona, but even if the surgery is later part of the day. And go back to the PFT slide. Okay, so PFT, you have missed an important component. See, whatever your forced vital capacity is, here also like DVT prophylaxis, if your bleeding risk is higher, so you are calculating the DVT prophylaxis accordingly. Here also, if you feel the surgery is must to save the life, no matter how bad his lungs are, so PFT sometimes can be ignored in terms of need of the surgery versus need of ventilation. So here you have to counsel the family. If we are operating on you, post-operatively, he'll go to the ICU. He'll be on ventilator. It may be invasive or non-invasive depending on his lung function. Currently, our lung function is weak because he's elderly. He smoked all his life and he's already on pumps. So perioperatively, he'll be on the ventilator. So do not ask the anesthetist to extubate. Do not wait in recovery room. Do not give extubation trial when he's unconscious. Do not hook him on a lot of oxygen that will increase his carbon dioxide. So thus patient who is needing a surgery and already is a COPD, PFT may not help you in terms of decision making. Second important decision making is a patient who is undergoing a non-thoracic surgery, means not lung resection, not CABG, where there is no trauma on the lungs directly. So non-thoracic surgery, FEV1, forced vital capacity at 1 second, expired exhaled vital capacity 1 second. Should be more than 1 liter for comfortable extubation. Okay. If FEV1 is less than 1 liter per second, that means he is not able to breathe out on the spirometer. So he is a case where he will need a ventilation perioperative. So sometimes some anesthetists will refuse the case. EMR nahi karao because FEV1 less than 1 liter. But again, for thoracic surgery, because we have to remove one lung, lung is bad, he is going for resection, he is going for CABG. Heart is more important than for life than the lung. So if even less than 1 liter, we explain them, he is on surgery, he needs a surgery and he'll be on ventilator, simple as that. But for GI surgeries where FEV1 is less than 1, you should defer the surgery for 4 to 6 weeks, refer him to the respiratory department, they should optimize his lung function and then do it. There are third category of patient whose PFT is good, but they are not able to do the PFT at all. Means they go and the report is inconclusive. Means they cannot even blow because they have active cough, they have a lung disease, but PFT is inconclusive. For them, you should do the next part of lung function is, as you rightly said, spirometer should be seen. If he's able to lift one of the balls and the three balls of the spirometer, that's also fair enough. But he should show us a good working capacity of his lung by walking. So that test is called 6-minute walk test. If he's able to walk for 6 minutes without desaturation, without a tachycardia, he is a good case to operate. So that's called 6-minute walk test. Many of our ILD patients, COPD patients who always reject the spirometer because em nathi thatuj nathi, or he, whenever they do, they increase their cough. So they go for 6-minute walk test. If 6-minute walk test does not show desaturation, or they are not tachypneic, they are not restless, they sit comfortably after the minute, and they are all not tachycardic above 120, the heart rate doesn't go off. So they are good patients to be operated on.
And in COVID, where I also era, this 6-minute walk is also checked as a routine.
So PFT is now, we are not doing PFT. So our PFT machine is closed, madam, since 3 months. So we are all doing 6-minute walk test. So if you're undergoing a midline laparotomy, if you're undergoing a Whipple surgery, if you're opening a blunt abdominal trauma, again, trauma does not mean you'll do PFT because trauma is always emergency. Any midline incision where you're splitting the diaphragm, you're actually taking care, not taking care of the both crural fibers of the diaphragm. Midline laparotomy, always check the PFT because that can be a nasty postoperative issue. A lot of pain itself will cause the diaphragm not to move postoperatively. It'll develop basal atelectasis and he may have respiratory complications postoperatively.
And which analgesics do you recommend in such respiratory?
Ma'am, yes, postoperatively for lung, if at all you really are worried about diaphragm and pain causing him less lung movement at the base, always regional is better. You put him on epidural and that will be the best for him to give you a good time for the next 3 days till he's mobilized by the surgical team. And if it is not possible, you give opioids.
Opioids, but contramal, it should not be given too much IV because for first 48 hours, we give IV contramal. And sometimes if patient is remain more sedated, then it creates more respiratory.
So you can, madam, gauze the effect of that contramal. You can gauze the effect and then you can comfortably give because opioids are better pain reliever as compared to the paracetamol, ma'am. Yes. So you should give, but when the patient starts behaving crankily, he has ear distension, he has some altered sensorium, stop it. And it is completely reversible, madam.
Yeah.
But I will take your leave. I have her slides. All these inputs I will give you at the end of the day when I'm finished. Okay, ma'am. So sorry, I have to leave a little early.
It's okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, professor. Thank you. Bye-bye, Juliet. All the best. Huh?
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
प्रीऑपरेटिव क्रिएटिनिन लेवल मोर देन 2 इज एन इंडिपेंडेंट रिस्क फैक्टर फॉर कार्डियक कॉम्प्लिकेशन सो फॉर गोल्स ऑफ प्रीऑपरेटिव इवैल्यूएशन इज आइडेंटिफिकेशन ऑफ कोएक्जिस्टिंग कार्डियोवास्कुलर डिसफंक्शन सर्कुलेटरी hematologic and metabolic derangements in patient with altered renal profile. Complications are associated with that is altered fluid and electrolyte homeostasis. That patient might have hypertension, peripheral edema, salt retention, electrolyte imbalance, acidosis. The hematological dysfunctions associated with renal system are anemia, coagulation defects, altered platelet adhesion and aggregation, and altered calcium and PTH metabolism. Patient will have proteinuria, so the nutritional status will also be affected, and there will be decreased body stores of nitrogen and decreased dietary intake. And immune functions are also affected since the proteins, that is immunoglobulins, are also excreted. So there will be increased risk of infections. So for preoperative optimization, anemia in CKD is treated with erythropoietin, and correction of hyperkalemia is to be done. Replacement of calcium for symptomatic hypocalcemia, use of phosphate binding antacids for hypophosphatemia, correction of metabolic acidosis, avoidance of nephrotoxic drugs preoperatively, and preoperative dialysis should be done 24 hours before elective surgery in CKD patients.
I would like to add in this that in any patient who are having CKD, you should check the urine output. Don't operate immediately on the next day. So you check the urine output. So how much is the urine output in comparison with the input of the patient? So post-operatively, you can follow up those patients that sometimes a few patients are having normal urine output and few patients are having less urine output. So this is a very simple thing, but in spite of blood test, you have to also check the urine output of the patient in 24 hours. Okay.
In hepatobiliary system, the risk stratification is done according to the Child-Pugh score, and the common problems seen in cirrhotic patients are malnutrition, poor appetite, hence ascites and abdominal pain. So this is the flow chart showing in patients with liver disease, when patient has to undergo a liver surgery, if the patient is in acute hepatitis, postpone the elective surgery at least until the liver function tests have normalized. In patient with chronic hepatitis, surgery is generally considered safe in such patients. Patients with obstructive jaundice, perioperative fluid management is done to prevent renal dysfunction. Dopamine and mannitol should be avoided. Lactulose may be helpful. Antibiotic prophylaxis is must. Preoperatively biliary drainage is not done. And check for abdominal coagulation prophylax parameter, and if altered, should be corrected. And in cirrhotic patients, based on Child Pugh score, patients with A and B score, ascites coagulopathy is treated first and then proceed for surgery. And in C, postpone until the patient's child class has improved. The common patients we see with ascites in cirrhotic patients is umbilical hernia. And the management, if the patient does not have features of obstruction or strangulation, we can wait to improve the ascites by fluid restriction and diuretics, and paracentesis may also be done. And once the ascites is controlled, then go for elective surgery for umbilical hernia. But if the patient has to be taken for emergency surgery, when there is obstruction or strangulation, the risk of post-op encephalopathy is very high in such patients. So that should be kept in mind.
We had seen so many patients with this type of umbilical hernia. They are coming to us when there is an irreducible hernia. And most of the time, there is an omentum which is plugging at the opening. And so there is a ascitic fluid which is present into this obstructed hernia, umbilical hernia. And in that case, if you get the good USG and they say there is only fluid, then you can just aspirate that fluid. In few cases, we have done like that. So the patient do not require surgery in that case. You just aspirate every fourth day, two times aspiration, and then you give strapping with the Dynaplas, and it do not require surgery. So because after doing surgery, sometimes it creates lots of complications because of the anesthesia. Okay.
Another important thing is when you are talking about liver, always talk about kidney simultaneously. Patients with hepatorenal syndrome, when you are talking about liver and all ascites and cirrhosis, just have a good look at the renal function of the patient, look at the urine output of the patient, and then consider surgery.
Preoperative
optimization.
Optimization in diabetic patient, morning dose of oral hypoglycemic agent should be omitted. Patient should be shifted on immediate or long-acting insulin that is to be started on the evening before the surgery according to the RBS of the patient. 5% dextrose should be started in the morning since the patient is kept NBM for a longer time and we have given insulin on the evening before surgery. And in some cases, insulin infusion pumps are used, but we don't use it commonly. For hypothyroidism patients, elective surgery should be postponed until the euthyroid status is achieved. Preoperative ECG and serum electrolytes are must. Antithyroid drugs and beta blockers are to be continued on the day of surgery. It is a very important point for patients undergoing thyroidectomy for Graves disease. And in case of emergency surgery in thyrotoxic patient, at risk there is a risk of thyroid storm. So combination of beta blocker and steroids is used in such cases. Patients with severe hypothyroidism can cause MI coagulation defects and electrolyte imbalance. So elective surgery should be postponed till the euthyroid status is achieved. In patients with history of steroid use or chronic hypothalamo-pituitary-adrenal axis suppression, patients who have taken more than 5 mg of prednisolone or equivalent for more than 3 weeks when undertaking major surgery can be a cause for unexplained hypotension in postoperative period. So if the patient is undergoing minor procedure, no additional steroid is required. But if the patient is undergoing major operation, 100 milligram of hydrocort is given IV bolus stat on the day of surgery, followed by 150 milligram per day for 2 to 3 days.
So those patients requires particularly follow up regularly, and if it is an extra major surgery, you can get the cortisol level of the serum cortisol level also. That is done in GCRA. So you get that level, and then accordingly we have to maintain that level post-operatively also. Okay. Continue.
In pheochromocytoma, it itself is a big topic in preoperative preparation, but a combination of alpha and beta blocker has started 1 to 2 weeks before surgery to avoid intraoperative hypertensive crisis or vascular collapse, and patient is kept on salt.
Wait, see, initially we start with alpha blocker and then we start beta blocker. We do not start both simultaneously.
First,
we start alpha blocker. Yeah.
To prevent the tachycardia caused by alpha blocker, then we add beta blocker.
Yeah. Okay.
And patient is kept on salt restricted diet. For anemia preoperatively, the guidelines, American Association of Blood Bank guidelines, transfusion is not indicated in hemodynamically stable patient with hemoglobin more than 10. And transfusion should be done preoperatively with hemoglobin more than less than 7 in adult or pediatric patient in ICU. And for post-op, if the HB is less than 8, blood transfusion is indicated. Patients on anticoagulation, we have discussed this. The warfarin and antiplatelet should be withheld before 5 days. And to get the INR less than 1.5, low molecular weight heparin should be stopped 24 hours before surgery, and it is restarted 48 to 72 hours after surgery. And unfractionated heparin should be stopped 6 hours before surgery, and it can be restarted 12 to 24 hours post-operative.
Finished?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. I think that very much completes everything. Of course, there are so many lacunae because each of these heading in itself is a lecture, liver functions and renal functions. But I think points well taken, especially the anesthesia classifications, the cardiac risks of the patient. We should be stopping anticoagulants before 5 days. And very importantly, smoking part, which we need to take care of. Ma'am?
Yeah, she has finished almost all the things and excellently presented. Good, Julie.
Okay, sure. Well done, Julie. Good. We'll leave then. Thank you, ma'am.
Okay.
Thank you, Julie.